How's it going, guys and girls? Hope you guys had a great week. So I am back today. It is Gaming News Friday, guys. So I'm back with another game-related news story this week. And this one today is actually focusing on E3. So E3 is really struggling at the moment, in my opinion. It's had a lot of really bad press around it. I mean, last year, Sony didn't attend, and they've confirmed again in January, they confirmed again that they're not going to be attending at E3 2020, which is a pretty big blow, to be fair, and kind of surprising. Particularly with the PlayStation 5 coming out, I was expecting that we would have some kind of presence at E3 this year, but Sony have confirmed that they're not going to be attending. Then obviously we had all the leaks last year with participants' personal data and information and email addresses all leaked, which was pretty embarrassing for the ESA. And then really to, you know, give one more dig at E3, Jeff Keighley, who's a pretty big name in the gaming industry, he's most well known for presenting the Colosseum at E3. He's also involved in the YouTube live streaming of the event, and obviously he's most well known for the Game Awards. Well, Jeff Keighley has always been a really, really big supporter of E3. He's been a massive presence at E3 for the last 25 years, and in an official statement today on his Twitter account, he actually confirmed that he will not be participating in E3 2020, and that is a massive blow for the ESA, and it's some pretty big news given how much of a supporter he has always been. So in an official statement, he basically said, and this is a statement from Jeff Keighley on E3, "For the past 25 years, I have attended every Electronic Entertainment Expo. Covering, hosting, and sharing E3 has always been a highlight of my year, not to mention a defining part of my career. I've debated what to say about E3 2020. While I want to support the developers who will showcase their work, I also need to be open and honest with you, the fans, about precisely what to expect from me. I've made the difficult decision to decline to produce E3 Colosseum. For the first time in 25 years, I will not be participating in E3. I look forward to supporting the industry in other ways and at other events in the future." So it's a pretty huge statement that he's not going to be there. Now, in terms of his reasons for that, he did go on his Twitter account and he did say, you know, "If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer here on social media." And obviously people have gone on and asked him, but his answers, to be fair, have been pretty vague as to his reasons. One commenter asked, you know, "What fueled your decision to not participate?" And Jeff responded, "A ton of factors. I just don't really feel comfortable participating given what I know about the show as of today. Ouch." Another commenter asked, "With Sony yourself and potentially others opting out of E3, is it even viable anymore? Why doesn't it carry the same industry weight it once did? And what changes should be made to keep it relevant?" And Keighley there responded, "I think E3 needs to be more digital and global. It's a brand that means a lot to people, but it shouldn't just be a show floor." So that's kind of all he publicly has stated via his Twitter account. Obviously, it's not surprising that he hasn't gone into tons and tons of detail. Of course, he won't be able to for certain reasons. There might be an NDA involved and he can't give too much information away in terms of what the ESA has planned, in terms of what's planned at E3 this year. I'm sure he signed some kind of contract in the past that means he can't give his, you know, detailed reasons and detailed statements. But he has given a little bit more information as to his views in a interview with Games Industry Biz, who did ask him for a little bit more information regarding his reasons for leaving, and he just shed a little bit more light on it. So let's go through that. This is an article on the gamesindustry.biz website. I will post a link to all these news articles in the comment section below, so you guys can obviously go along yourselves and read them. They are quite an interesting read. So let's have a look at some of the information that he's given. Well, in a statement here, he said, "Given what has been publicly communicated about plans for E3 2020, I just don't feel comfortable participating in the show at this time." He then goes in and talks a little bit about his kind of views on what he wants E3 to be and his thoughts on E3 this year as planned. So he does say that E3 is at an interesting transition point. We're at an interesting inflection point, he says, between physical and digital events. And certainly E3 is in the middle of a transition, evolving from what was traditionally an industry trade show. As someone who attended E3 for more than 2.5 decades, there are of course a lot of emotions, but when you look at it objectively, E3 is really just an idea about uniting the industry and fans to celebrate the medium on a global scale. The future of E3 will be determined based on how effective the brand is at delivering against that goal. I absolutely think that there's a way forward for the brand of E3, this is just my take, but I think E3 needs to be more digital, global and inclusive in its approach to connecting gamers and celebrating the industry. It's not really about who buys a booth on the show floor. Anyone who participated in the game festival on Steam around the Game Awards probably has a pretty good sense of my vision for how we bring the world together around games. So what he's talking about there is there was a really cool thing that he did during the Game Awards on Steam where certain titles became available to download and play trial versions or demos of those games. And he gave gamers an opportunity to try out different games that are set to be released, you know, in the near or distant future, and I thought that was really good and I really really enjoyed it, and I'm completely support that kind of thing. It sounds like, you know, from what he's saying here, Jeff Keighley really doesn't like the direction that E3 is going in, and he doesn't like the plans for 2020, and for him to pull out, someone who's always been a massive supporter of E3, that is quite a damning statement, in my opinion, for perhaps what the ESA has planned. Now, Keighley is not the only one to mention a dissatisfaction or concern over the direction that E3 is going. In an official statement back in January, on the 13th of January, when PlayStation announced that it was also not planning to participate in E3 this year, in an interview with GamesIndustry.biz as well, they did kind of say a very similar thing. So in a direct statement, Sony basically said that after thorough evaluation, they had decided not to participate in E3 2020. We have great respect for the ESA as an organization, but we do not feel the vision of E3 2020 is the right venue for what we are focused on this year. So again, you know, Sony saying they don't like the direction that E3 is going in. Now, there was a supposed leak or some information about a proposed plan that the ESA had for E3 2020. This was on the news outlet Game Daily, which came out in September last year, and it sort of revealed a little bit of information on a proposed plan by the ESA in terms of what their vision for E3 2020 was going to be. And there was this focus on Q-tainment and this idea that E3 this year would be more of a fan, media and influencer festival. There'd be more of a focus on celebrities and influencers and social media than actual games, which is really what E3 should be about. And there's this whole idea of, you know, celebrities, for example, the Los Angeles Lakers would be showcased playing a basketball video game in front of fans or actors competing in a tournament that people could go along to actually watch and see. There was this whole idea as well with the shop floor being more of an experience for people attending, so they would be different experience hubs that people could go along to, I guess, to get some kind of gaming experience or something. But there was definitely a view more towards media, influencers and paid celebrity deals rather than actual developers coming up on stage and talking about their games and showcasing their games. It definitely seems to lean more in that direction. There was also this whole idea of Q-tainment, which is this whole idea of when people are queuing in booths to play games. Sometimes those queues can be quite long, and it was talking about giving them some form of entertainment while waiting to play or get hands-on with a game demo. And this entertainment would obviously take the form of advertising, where developers or publishers would try to sort of promote other brands and the other games that they've got available and other things that they can offer. So it just seems very consumer focused, and I can kind of understand if that is the way that E3 is going. It's not particularly a direction that I'm a big fan of. I don't like this whole idea of influencers, social media influencers and celebrities. I don't like that focus. For me, E3 was always an exciting period of time in the year because it was the time when all the big developers and publishers would present games that they've got coming out. The most interesting for me was when we got to see some actual demos being played. We actually got really interesting interviews with developers where they'd be talking about what they're working on and their visions for games. And you know, it was a really cool time for the gaming community to kind of come together and to get excited about it. Now obviously over the last couple of years, Nintendo pulled out in terms of having a conference at E3 and then started to use their Nintendo Direct, which worked really well, but they still have a presence on the shop floor. Microsoft are still there, but their conference is at their own venue, not at the LA Convention Center, but it is close by. EA have also started doing their own conference and their own venue and area at EA Play and showcasing a live stream on what they have to offer. And obviously now Sony have completely pulled out. They weren't there last year and they're not going to be there this year, which is quite damning, particularly given that the PlayStation 5 is coming out. And you would expect E3 this year to have been more exciting than ever, particularly with the next gen consoles coming out. The Xbox One Series X is coming out, the PlayStation 5 is coming out. I remember when the Xbox One and the PlayStation 4 were announced and there was so much hype and excitement surrounding that, and people tuning in and watching the conferences and watching them showcase these consoles and the different games that they had on offer. I for one have always really enjoyed the E3 Coliseum. I've always really enjoyed the interviews with developers and seeing what the different development teams have to say. And I'm really sad to see that it's going to be going away from that and focusing more on celebrities. I'm not interested in watching famous footballers or famous basketball players playing a basketball game. I could not care less. I want to hear from the people making those games, the people that are passionate about those games. And I am sad. I'm definitely sad to see that E3 seems to be losing its popularity or its focus or even its drive. It'll be interesting to see what E3 is like this year. I've always wanted to go to E3, I've just never been able to afford it. But if it definitely is going this way in terms of focusing on, you know, Q-tainment and influencers and celebrities and more focusing on, like, you know, different booths, it's a little bit more like the Tokyo Game Show than what I would expect from E3. So I always like watching the conferences. For me, the highlight of E3 is always the conferences. That's always the side of it I really enjoy. And then I also really like to tune in to all the interviews that the different news outlets do with game developers. And I always pay close attention to those in terms of all the extra snippets of information that we can get. And they always showcase, you know, different types of gameplay. So I am disappointed with this news. It's not the end of the world that Jeff Keighley is going to be there. He's not the highlight for me of E3, but I still think it's a pretty big blow for the ESA. And it certainly doesn't give a very confident outlook in terms of, you know, what E3 is going to be like this year and what to expect. So it'll be interesting to see what people say about E3, those that have attended this year. And it'll be interesting to see what actually happens, whether Jeff Keighley will do something separate from E3, whether he'll still do something with the YouTube live streaming of it. Obviously, he's not even going to be there or participating, so how he's going to actually cover it, we'll have to wait and see whether or not he is, or if he's just going to completely skip it entirely and maybe just focus on Gamescom and then the Game Awards later on. I guess we'll have to see. But yeah, it's pretty big news that Jess Keighley is not going to be there this year, and I was really surprised when I found that out this morning. So what are your thoughts on this latest news development on E3, guys? What are your thoughts about Jeff's announcement? What do you think his reasons are behind not attending this year? Do you think it's going to hurt E3? What do you think E3 is going to be like? And what are your views on the new direction that the ESA seem to be taking E3 in terms of influencers and paid celebrities? What are your views on that? And what are your predictions for E3 this year? Let me know in the comment section below what your thoughts are. If you enjoyed the video, obviously please show your support by liking, commenting. Don't forget to hit that bell notification if you are subscribed to make sure that you get update information every time I upload any new content. Anyway, hope you guys are having a great week. Take care, and as always, happy gaming. Bye, guys.